Traditional display. Traditional flat display, we'll talk about that. What are the difference? And we'll answer this question, how do we perceive depth? And why do we have binocular vision? I mean, anybody knows why we have two eyes and not one? To perceive depth, right? Try holding one finger like this with one eye, you will not be able to do that because you won't know exactly how deep that comes from both. That's why we have binocular vision, and that's what we are trying to copy or mimic in VR and computer vision field. And we'll see what is, so stereo image is related to binocular vision. So depth cues, how do we get depth cues? So you would have seen these kind of things, and you know, this shows that the robot is pretty long. Why do we see that? Because of perspective narrowing. So when things go further, our perspective vision starts to narrow it, and that's how we feel the depth cue, or we feel that this particular object, in even though it's a two-dimensional image, is pretty deep. The other is sizes of known objects. So we know an average human height, and if what you see is a larger human height compared to some other human which are smaller, so we perceive that, you know, those which are larger are closer to your eye, and those who are smaller are further away. Occlusion is one thing, something which occludes something else has to be in front of that thing. Lighting, shadow, relative motion, they all contribute to, so we don't even realize what all goes on in our brain and between our eye and brain, which makes us see the depth. And these are all the things. So depth cues from binocular vision, you can see this pinball. When you see from the left eye, it shows like this. When you see from the right eye, it shows like this. So they are two different images, and they are called stereo images. And when they form on your retina in the brain, the brain interprets the depth from this, what we call difference between the two images. And other way, that's called retinal disparity. The other concept is called convergence. Convergence is rotation of the eye in viewing close objects. So when you view something very close, your eyeballs converge. And when they converge, the muscle movement makes the brain think that you are focusing on something which is very close. And by virtue of our experience of the entire life, the brain immediately thinks that this is 1 feet apart. And muscle tension in the eye in doing different depth also contributes towards perceiving the depth. So this we have talked about the different. So same object is seen by different eyes, which producing different results, which create a stereoscopic display, which contributes towards creating the depth. So these are all different. So stereo pair or stereo vision is the base on which VR has been built. You see, even though what you see on your phone screen in your HMD, in your Gear VR, they are still flat displays. But because of the disparity in both the images, you start feeling the depth, and you start feeling as if you are virtually there, immersed in that environment. So there have been several attempts of making, you know, a stereo pair generation. So this you would have seen in your childhood, you know, anaglyph 3D. There were movies earlier. So what it's doing is one eye is getting only blue images, the other eye will only get red images, and those, so there all the edges are blue to red, and that's how you perceive the depth in the picture. The other concept is polarized glass, which is what is used in IMAXs and movie theaters these days, Avatars and other movies, where what you wear is basically a polarized glasses. So polarized glasses let the light with different phases pass through differently from each of the eyes. So there again, you are getting some kind of binary or some kind of stereo images in your brain. Then there is something called shutter glasses, the spin doubling. What it is actually is, it is used in a scenario in which a display is alternatively producing left image and the right image, and at the same frequency, your left shutter and the right shutter is opening. So what you are seeing is left image from left eye, right image from right eye, and then you see that forms the stereo pair, and you feel the depth perception. The latest is HMDs, and we'll see how HMDs produce. We will see into the underlying technologies why HMDs let you perceive depth in when you put them on. So this is an example of COP rendering. So technical challenges in VR, there are a lot of technical challenges that were, I mean, HMDs were there 15 years back also, but they were never able to become mainstream because of the underlying technical challenges that were not solved at that time till Michael Abrash and Palmer Lucky came out with Oculus Rift headset DK1, and then rest is history. So they solved these problems. Field of view, they increase the field of view. It's too narrow, you won't feel the immersion. Chromatic aberration due to lenses, you remember your chromatic physics, light disperses at different frequencies when it passes through a lens. That those concepts were solved in software and hardware. Optical distortion lens, when we see something from a magnifying glass from too close, we can see the things getting distorted. So those things are solved. Head tracking is solved. When I move around my head, the system immediately knows I moved my head at what angle and at what along what vector. Those exact information goes to the VR system. Position tracking, when I'm moving inside a VR system like this, it knows exactly where I'm positioned so that, you know, it can track the virtual camera inside the VR scene. So all this is done internally in the VR SDK and Unity VR interface. Latency, motion to photon, that is minimized. The screens were made high resolution. I mean, even now, if you put on HTC Vive, anybody has experienced HTC Vive or Oculus Rift TV One? So quite a few of you. So you would have seen, you still remember seeing some kind of a screen door effect. You still see nigel pixels. So those are because of this resolution is still not up to the par. But those things are improving. Display refresh rate, how to achieve 60 FPS, that majority of the software solutions that are there in Oculus and Steam SDK contribute towards getting higher and higher frames per second. So immersion requires a large field of view. We all agree to that, right? I mean, we are feeling immersed here because we can see a 190 degree field of view. But if it's, I can only see it through a small field of view, you won't feel the perception. So how do we achieve high field of view, or at least what is available in HTC Vive and Oculus Rift VR? So one idea was to do something like this. Put a spherical dome over you. I don't think that's a very good idea. I mean, Toshiba tried doing this and it failed miserably, but it was a good attempt in producing some kind of a high field of view display. But of course, this is not practical. Then what we use right now, these days, is convex lens to increase the field of view. How we do that, I'll show you. So you can see here, without, if you keep a screen in front of your eye, maybe 10 inches from your eye, this is the field of view that is formed at the eye, which is very, very narrow. But put a magnifying glass here and the field of view becomes very big. And that is what is at the crux of how HMDs are made. They have optics which gives you a larger field of view for the same screen size. But optics cause distortion. We all have seen in our physics lecture that, you know, put something very close to a magnifying lens and it distorts. So how do you fix those things? How do Oculus or HTC Vive SDKs fix those things internally? So if this is a checkered board or a grid like this, when you see it through a magnifying glass, that's how it will look. So what we can, what is desired here is when we see that through the magnifying glass, it should still look the same aspect ratio and without any distortion. The way we do is the solution is to apply barrel distortion to the image. So when we apply barrel distortion, this is called barrel distortion, this is called pin cushion distortion. When we apply barrel distortion, the original image becomes like this. Now when we see it through the lenses, it becomes like what the original image used to be. So that's called that's how we remove distortion in the optics. So some examples of distortion, this is the image when seen through lenses will look like this. The barrel distorted to this and then it looks flat. So there are three ways to fix distortion. Google Cardboard does it in a different manner. Oculus SDK does it in a different manner. Steam VR, which is HTC Vive SDK, does it in a different manner. So the most basic or simplest form of, I don't think that is visible to you guys because these are very fine grids. But what the idea here is that we render the left and right eyes onto texture. So how many guys, how many of you are aware with the OpenGL programming or graphics pipeline? So you know texture mapping and the concept of texture mapping, right? So we render onto the left and right eye images into a texture, process that texture with a fragment or pixel shader. All of you know what pixel shader is? Okay, so 1 minute introduction to 3D graphics. So a vertex is passed through a graphics pipeline and that results in a pixel onto the display. So it goes through multiple stages. The first stage is called vertex shader, then the second stage is called rasterizer, and the third stage is called pixel shading. So I mean, you can look it up to get some basic information about how 3D graphics work. But vertex shader are operation are which are done inside GPU on each vertex, and then each vertex is scanned to create a raster image, which is pixels. And then a program called pixel shader, which again runs on GPU, is applied onto pixel shader to do like texture mapping onto this or to apply some distortion. So vertex shader operation, pixel shader operation are both programs that run on GPU and work on a vertex or a pixel before you have a final frame buffer or the displayed image onto the screen. So what we do is this fragment-based solution is we render onto the left and right eye onto a texture, process that texture with a fragment or a pixel shader. I mean, Microsoft called this fragment shader, Microsoft called this pixel shader. And OpenGL, which is Linux side, calls it fragment shader. So process that texture into a fragment shader, moving each pixel inward in relation to the centroid of the eye. So that is simple understanding, right? So this is essentially like a grid. You move each pixel a little bit inward from both sides. So, I mean, we won't see the pixel, but there are pixels all around here. So that is done. So that applies the barrel distortion onto the original image, and then when you see that from the lens, you see the flat image. It's least efficient because there are lots of pixels, and each pixel is processed separately in pixel shader, and that is a very expensive operation. So this was primarily done where power is not a concern, because if it's not efficient, it will consume more power. So this was primarily done for PC-based VR SDK. This is mesh-based solution. So I talked about the previous solution was barrel distortion in the pixel shader stage. This is distorts the vertices of a relatively sparse grid. So this is distortion in the vertex shader space. So you distort the vertices of a relatively sparse grid, typically 40 by 40 by 20, and So you create a mesh or a grid, distort it, and then apply, when you apply this flat texture onto the distorted grid or distorted mesh, then that texture also will become distorted. So that's how we achieve barrel distortion in mesh-based solution. The best solution, which is used by mobile VR or Google Cardboard and Daydream VR, because the power is the main consideration there for mobile-based VR, is vertex displacement-based solution. So geometry itself is distorted using custom vertex shader. So the geometry or the three-dimensional mesh that is coming, that itself is distorted in the vertex shader stage, and then convert the world space vertex into inward lens distorted screen space using Brown Conradi model for radial distortion correction. The resulting 2D render is already barrel distorted, no render to immediate texture. So this saves two things. This saves power because this operation happens in vertex shader, which is far few than how many pixels are there. And there is no need for a double pass rendering, or there is no two pass rendering, which is required in the first method. So this is a single pass rendering. So this results in sharper looking rendering. Two pass approach can cause aliasing. There are no anti-aliasing here. There are no aliasing here because of one single pass rendering. But the disadvantage could be mesh should be dense. If it's a very sparse mesh, then so any of you know what affine transformations are? Affine transformation. So affine transformation is a geometrical transformation where if you apply that transformation on line, the line becomes still a line and not a curve in the transformed space. So if the mesh is not dense, then the line joining two vertices will not get distorted. That will still be a line because it's a big line. So that's a disadvantage. In the bottom line, mesh should be dense for this kind of this method to work well. So optics causes chromatic aberration. We all have seen, right? I mean, when the light passes through a lens, it disperses based on the frequency of the or the wavelength of that particular color. That's why we see an image like this. So you can see the rainbow kind of effect on the edges everywhere. And that is called chromatic aberration, which is caused by refraction, dispersion, inability of a lens to focus all color in the same place. Red and blue component of light has different indices of refraction and different focal length. So the way it is corrected is two ways. One is software correction. So I talked about the Brown's model in the previous slide. So applying the same thing, the classic Brown's model distortion correction formula to each color channel independently with different coefficient for each color. So you apply the same distortion on each color channel with a different coefficient for each color. That will make all the colors converge onto the same place after it passes through the lens. And so that is changing the red, green and blue color channel to a different scale. So this is what happens in a chromatic aberration, and this is how it is fixed in VR. This image is distorted based on the Brown's model, and then when you see it from the lens, all the colors are at the same place. Then the other correction is hardware correction using a lens called achromatic lenses. These are combination of a convex and a concave lens. This type of lens is usually composed of two individual